Þá bara höldum við áfram með dagskrána og næstur á dagskrá er Í pattir minn búin að lóka á mig hérna. Sem sagt, Lars Mittiby, framkvæmdastjóri Danske Handicaps Organisationer, sem eru systur samtöku ÖBI í Danmörku, ætlar að flytja erindi það hvort að fleira fatlað fólk sé á vinnumarkaði núna en fyrir 2013 þegar Danir fóru í kerfisbreytingar á sínu kerfi. I'd like to welcome Lars Mittiby to the podium. His speech is going to be on the Danish reforms. Are more people with disability on the labor market or just less social security? And your slides are... Okay. Do you have the equipment for the slides?
Yeah, okay. I have now. Thank you, and thank you very much for inviting me to participate in this seminar today. I think it's an extremely important theme, and in general I think it's important for us to exchange views and to learn from each other. As just said, I'm director for the Danish Disabled People's Organization. We are 34 member organization, and we are representing together 330,000 members. We are an old organization. We are established in 1934. And my main focus will be, we agreed upon that, about how people with disability are included in the Danish labor market and how people with disability have been affected by the recent reforms that have been on the labor market reforms. But before that, I would like to come with a few positive news, because we've just, here in the spring, had a general legislation about anti-discrimination in Denmark. We have had anti-discrimination legislation on the labor market for many years, but now recently we have got a general legislation, so I think that is very good. And also I want to say that, because that is one of the things that we've been working on for a long time, and we're doing it with the leading star, so to speak, as a UN convention, and we see that some a very important tool also in this aspect. The Danish system... Oh, sorry. Here you go. The Danish system, I've been told that the Iceland government is looking into the Danish system and is inspired by some of the reforms from 2012 in Denmark. And let me just jump directly to the main conclusion. The reform from 2012 have been a huge challenge for many people with disability in Denmark. So don't be too inspired, or at least learn from some of the challenges and some of the things that have been going wrong. Right now, the Liberal Conservative government is moving back on some of the elements of the reforms, and the chairperson for the Danish Social Democratic Party just said in a huge conference piece this weekend, she was minister when the reform was done, that if she takes in office as prime minister, she will change quite a lot in the reform, because it has worked out in another way than she hoped when the reform was voted through in parliament. So, and I'd like to tell you about the experiences so we can learn from each other, and both what is good, and there is some good element in the reform as well, but also be frank about the things that have been challenging. And now, in the agenda for today, as I said, I'll give an introduction to the Danish system, how is the possibilities to be part of the labor market, then the political change in 2012, because it was such a huge change, and how it had developed since, and then the concluding remarks. there's different ways to be on the labor market in Denmark if you are a person with disability. There's or how you can get your income. We have a disability pension, or actually it's more right to translate it, early retirement pension. And it's for the people who is not able to work in any way, or at least it's very, very little working capacity. I'll come back to that. Then we have got flex job for those who can work in a limited capacity. Usually it's not more than 20 hours, and it can be much less than that. And then, of course, we have the ordinary labor market for everybody else. And it's important to say that the ordinary labor market, also there's a lot of government and municipality support to be part of the labor market. So you can be granted personal assistant if you need that to be able to be part of the labor market. You can also be granted support to rebuild an office if it's not accessible. There's a lot of different support, and I think that is in general rules that are working well in Denmark, the possibility to get support to be part of the ordinary labor market. And then we had the political reform in 2012. And as I said, it was huge changes. And it came out of mainly I'll say it was a financial crisis, so it was also to make some cuts. And there was a political wish for fewer people to be granted a disability pension and more people to be part of the active labor force. The flexjob system was changed very much to include those with lower working capacity. Until 2012, it was like people working between 10 and 20 hours. But since the reform in 2012, there's no lower limit. So you can actually have a flex job, even though you're just able to work 1 hour a week or so. So there's no time limit in that way. And then as an important part of the reform, there was an introduction of local rehabilitation teams and resource activation programs. And these teams and programs were made to put more focus, or much more focus, on whether it was possible to develop a work capacity. So you're not only looking at whether this person is able to be part of the labor market, you also look very much into whether you think it is possible with an activation program, with the working very intense with, to find a way to make people able to be part of the labor market. And these, and these rehabilitation teams is one of the cornerstone in the reform. And I think that they have brought something good into the system, actually. In all 98 Danish municipalities, there is a rehabilitation team now. And the rehabilitation teams are introduced to all the citizens whose working capacity is limited and who is target group for either a pension, a flex job, or a resource activation program. And what was new was that these rehabilitation teams is representative from different sectors. And early on, it have been a real challenge that sort of the welfare state have been too much into different silos. So you have a social sector, a healthcare sector, labor market sector, but now the system has to talk more together, sit together around the same table, And the aim is for the team to provide a counseling on the best way for the citizen to increase their working capacity. And as I said, the Danish disability organizations have been very positive to this element, but it has only been a concealing, and it's still the local municipalities that decide whether to grant a person a pension or not. And then another part of the reform was these resource activation programs. In cases where a resource activation program is given to a citizen, it is the local municipality that is responsible for carrying it out. And I'll talk more about the development since the reform later on, but let me just be clear that these programs have been a flop in many ways, because as I said, the municipalities is responsible to carrying it out, and it has been very, very different how they have been carried out and what actually have been put into them. So if you're inspired by this part of the reform, it's very important to how you implement it. The municipality is supposed to use the cross-sectoral input for the rehab team to compose a plan that fits the specific needs for each citizen. A citizen can be given a resource activation program, and it can be between 1 and 5 years. And you can say this, it can be no longer than 5 years, but it is possible to give another resource activation program after these 5 years, and there's no upper limit how many resource activation programs you can go through, which is one of the weaknesses that we have been pointing out, and which I think we'll be looking at in the future. I think that element will be changed, so there'll be an upper limit how many years you can be in different resource activation programs. While in a resource activation program, the government financial assist is low at the level of basic social security. So what has happened with the disability pension or early retirement pension as of the reform from 2012? It has been in practice, they've put almost a general rule that no one is supposed to receive disability pension before having been through a resource activation program. And another almost general rule, not an actual rule, but it feels like it is that no one under the age of 40 is supposed to receive a disability pension at all. Disability pension is supposed to be for those who positively have no working capacity in regards to the ordinary labor market. To be fair, I should say that it is possible to get a pension even though no, you're not 40, but then it has to be absolutely obviously that it's not possible to develop any kind of working capacity. So, in other words, it is become very difficult to get a pension in Denmark. And I'll come back to the development since 2012, but it has become too difficult, and there have been a lot of media fuss about this. Very disabled people, very sick people who's refused to get a pension. And right now, I think things are changing. I think there's a political direction now that will come to roll some of the reform back in the future, because in general it's not seen as a fair reform. It's not really worth a welfare society. And then we have the flex job. As I said, it's for people with a limited working capacity. And the system is like a citizen are hired at a company, and the company is paying before 2012, it was the person was paid as they were working full time, even though they only have a limited working capacity. The employer would then receive a compensation from the local authorities. And as I said, usually it was between 10 and 20 hours. After the reform, you change so the citizen are paid by their employer only for the hours they actually work, and then they receive a governmental support for the hours they cannot work. But it's more the rest of the hours they only get similar to pension. So now it's not able. Now you cannot get a full-time pay anymore. So the level of financial compensation for FlexJob have been falling dramatically, and of course that is a huge challenge. Now I'll go to and look into the development since 2012. I've touched upon it a couple of times, but as you probably already can feel, the changes have been pretty dramatically. And when we look into how the rehabilitation teams have worked out, as I said, in general, we have been positive towards the cross-sectoral starting point of the rehabilitation teams. But in practice, they've put into play way too late. So we are now putting pressure to start these rehabilitation teams much more early. And another thing is that they are not able to actually to make the decision. They're only concealing to the municipalities, and we like them actually to be able to make the decisions, because when you have all these people together around the table, they should also be able to move to take the decision, and they are probably more likely to make the right decisions. And the resource activation programs, at this point of the program, it has been really not a success. I'll be more fair to say it has been a complete flop. There have been a lot of stories in the media telling stories about activation programs with totally meaningless things, and even something that you say you are in a resource activation program, but it's actually nothing is done. So while the idea might be good, this has been not been the case in practice. The problems in particular has been that there have been very long resource activation programs. But they've been put into play too late, and there've been nothing really done to make them work. So it's more like just make the way to get a pension very, very, very long. So it has to be much more clear what at least should be part of an activation program, if it should be used. So I think a vast number of citizens in resource activation program, they should not at all have been in a resource program. They should just have been had a pension directly. And again, I think this is one of the points that we are looking at right now, to make it more clear that more people should be able to get a pension without a resource activation program. So it's more clear that it's only if there's a fair chance to develop people's working capacity, you should use these activation programs. as it worked out, it's more like if it's not completely positive that you cannot develop people's working capacity, you should go through an activation program. And of course, it's very difficult to say that there's not any chance that you can develop a working capacity. So that is a huge weakness in the reform. So here you can see one of the results of the reforms, a significant drop in disability pensions granted. So instead of many people have been sent into resource activation program and often without much activity and there have been no results. So you can see there have been, after a couple of years, there have been a bit more people getting granted a pension, and it's because some of the activation programs have been ended and then people are granted a pension. But still, even here a couple of years after the reform, it's still a dramatic drop. And you can look at all kind of different kind of disabilities where there have been a dramatic drop. And when it comes to FlexJob, due to the change in the FlexJob program, thousands of new FlexJobs have been created. So FlexJob can now be only a few hours a week. But as I told only early on, then the income is very low as well. But it is, the change is not good, but the FlexJob system in general is good. And we have had an increase of people in FlexJob from 50,000 to 75,000. And the number is still increasing now. But still, even though there have been a good increase in number of jobs, there's still a high unemployment rate for people who is granted a flex job, still around 16%. And that's compared to, in general, the unemployment rate in Denmark is very low at the moment. I think it's 4 or 4.5%. So there's really a huge gap. The job which is created is both created in the private sector and in the public sector. And again, you can get a variety of different kind of support when you're in a flex job. You can have personal assistant, you can have whatever is needed kind of things, a special chair, special lamp. You can get rebuilt in the office is if it's necessary to be able to have this flex job. And all of this is compensated by the local municipalities. So in that way, it is easy, or pretty easy, for employers to get people with disability to be part of the labor market. But there is a challenge that many companies don't know these rules and think it is more difficult than it actually is. So this is one of the things that we are working on at the moment, is just to tell about these, that it's not expensive for the companies, and it's very easy to be an inclusive workplace. But it's quite difficult to do that. But as you see, there have been an increase in number of flex jobs, and we see that as a positive, very positive things. Concluding remarks, some of the positive incentives in regards working across sector is rehabilitation teams and resource activation programs. However, the positive potential has not been materialized because these activation programs have been so poorly implemented by the local authorities. but still in the organizations, we are still positive towards working cross-sectoral, because I think that has been one of the challenges, that you don't see the problem in general. You just only have a single focus, and usually to solve the problem, it's necessary to look cross-sectoral. So even though we would like many of the things of the reforms to be changed, we would like to still have focus on that local authorities should be working cross-sectoral. But many people have not been given a disability pension. Instead, they have been sent through a poor resource activation program, which have been dragging out for years. And since the reform, we have been seeing a lot of flex jobs. However, this also have led to high unemployment rate. We still see that this is one of the areas that it's actually possible to do something about, and we think there is a growing interest in Danish companies to be more inclusive. And of course, it's more easy when it's in general the economy is going well, and some of the companies find it difficult to hire enough people and to get them. Then some of them find it easier to have to make it or find it attractive to be a more inclusive workplace. So in these years, we of course will try to put more focus on this. And actually, some of the result of the media thoughts about the reform is that there's more political focus on how to create a more inclusive labor market in Denmark in general. So we have a promise from the Minister of Labor in Denmark that in next week he'll present a proposal with a number of different elements on how to create a more inclusive labor market. So, and that is a liberal conservative government. So, and I think that is very good. And I'll keep you informed about what is actually part of this proposal. But we have been in a very good dialogue. So I think in that aspect we have seen a change where there's more focus on getting people to be part of the labor market and not just accepting people to stand out. But I've been frank to you to say that there's element of the reform that I think is good and could be taken into account, but hopefully you'll not make the same mistake that I've done in Denmark, because it has been a huge challenge for many people with disability. Thank you. And of course, I'll be more than willing to answer any question you'll have about the issue and how the system is working in Denmark. Also, if there's anything other than what I've been talking about now, so you're interesting to hear.
Thank you, Lars, for this. We actually have a question. It is the change of 2012. How has this affected people who are applying for disability pension but who do not live in Denmark anymore, i.e. people who have acquired rights by having lived for so many years in Denmark but have moved away?
The reform from 2012 doesn't change anything for people who is granted a disability pension. It's only for new. So if you have granted a pension, you will not have any changes.
But the question is on people that are applying for the disability pension now, have acquired the right but haven't had the pension yet.
But if you have granted the pension, there will be no changes.
Yes, but the question says have acquired the rights but haven't applied yet.
Okay, if you're not applied, then you'll be. I don't think there's any change whether you live in Denmark or you live in any other EU countries. If you come back and you apply for a pension, then it will be the rules at the time where you apply, even though you were entitled to get a pension before.
Okay.
So then it will be the new rules.
Okay. I'm not quite, it says, what sorts of jobs were offered? I don't understand the last word. Okay, are these all sorts of jobs or just low-paying jobs or?
Flex job can be, is it flex job you're asking to? Or can be all kind of jobs. So you can, yeah. And it is all kind of jobs. So we know, yeah, it can be low paid, whatever. You can be a lawyer in a flex job. You can be whatever. It's only focus on your working capacity, limited the number of hours.
Okay. Which is the difference between minimum wage and the pension? Is there a difference?
I think the pension is a little lower than the minimum wage, but it's almost the same.
Okay. Which are the primary mistakes on the rehabilitation program in Denmark we should avoid?
I mean, first of all, I think the activation programs, you have to be very clear what should actually be put into them. And then I think it's important that you don't drag these activation programs out for too many years, have to be a time limit so people know whether they should go in a job or they actually could get a pension. Right now, many people are going through a very, very long period of time where it's uncertain whether you'll get a pension or not.
Mm-hmm. Is minimum pay or minimum pension defined by law in Denmark?
Yeah.
Okay. Now I have a question.
No, minimum wages is not by law. It's agreement between the Fagforening and it's collective bargaining in Denmark.
Okay, but the minimum pension is.
But the social pension is by law.
Okay. Now I have a, let's see. What is the minimum pension in Denmark?
In Danish kroner, so it's between 18 and 19,000 Danish crowns a month.
Okay.
And should I try to make it into Iceland?
Yes, please.
I think it will be around 300,000.
Okay, thank you.
Crowns a month.
I have a question now for Sigurlaug Sofía. Þú nefndir í erindiðinu að úrskurðarvald vanti og segir að annars haldist ekki friður á milli manna. Sáttanefndir voru lagðar niður á Íslandi, telur að það hafi verið afturför og hvernig sjáum við neikvæða þætti þessa?
Já, ég hef, er þó talan sáttanefndir tilslefið það á að áður en að máli farið fer fyrir dómstóla.
Frímann, hvað meintir með þessu?
Ég ekki ára nokkra vissi með hvað bindum við þú að gert með sáttanefndu voru alltaf laðandi.
Já. Þá þyrfti að vantilega vera þá sáttanefndi þá einhvers konar samræði sem á sér stað á milli já, í sveitfélum, samræði sem á sér stað á milli fatlafólks og stjórnvalda. Já. Já, ég skilji. Þá var sjálfsögum framfærsku, ég myndi ég halda að það skortir, fullu fólki skortir bara rödd inn til stjórnvalda. Nei, framfærsbúra að koma þið aftur upp, myndi ég segja, að því það þarf bara, já. En þetta vonandi þá eitthvað sem að væri hægt að leggja fram. 1992, já. Ok. Einmitt. Já, það heyrist ekkert. Það er svo að spurningin var svo sáttanefndir sem voru hér við líði áður fyrr, hvort það er þið framfæra að skrefa að koma þeim aftur upp. það er þá einhvers konar samtal sem myndi eiga þessi stað milli fatlaðs fólks og stjórnvalda og ég tók undir það það er klárt framfaraskref þá þyrfti mál ekki að fara allar leið fyrir dómstóla til þess að fá niðurstu þá réttindi fatlaðs fólks og, og hvað þau hvað fatlað fólk hefur á rétt árum en þessi lámast þá framfærsla ef það samtal gæti á sér stað einhvers konar sáttanefndin þá ég sé ekki annað en það gæti bara orði til hins betra
Það komin kaffitími við tökum hlé til 10:50
And
okay.
Did you just say it was break or
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, I just would like to say one more thing is that in Denmark it's actually like there's a lot of people who is able people with disability who's able to work but who's not part of the workforce because it's difficult to get a job. And I think one of the things that is important to do if you really want people with disability to be part of the labor force is to make it easy for the companies to hire people with disability. So even though the Danish system on that point not as perfect, I think they're doing something right because it is actually easy to get help to if you need a small reconstruction to make an office accessible, whatever you need, a special things. And I think that is the first thing because many people, many companies might think, oh, it's difficult or expensive, or at least we don't know much about people with disability, we better not hire. And then I think just to overcome that, you should have a system where it's very easy to get help so you can get started. So yeah, I just want to say that even though it's not part of the 2012 reform, it is, I think it's a cornerstone if you want to make an inclusive labor market.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Now there is coffee.
Hi.